Welcome back, and in this video I'm going to step through physical and virtual servers. If you understand both of these, when I cover container architecture in a future video, it will make more sense and the differences will be obvious. Now, I don't want to waste too much time on this, so let's jump in and get started. Physical servers should be pretty easy to understand for anyone who's worked in IT for any length of time. Generally, you buy physical servers up front, meaning you own 100% of the capacity of that physical server. The flip side, though, is that if you have a failure, it's 100% your problem. Anything running on this server will stop, and you need to handle any hardware repairs or replacements. A server really is just a collection of hardware. Things like a motherboard, some CPUs, a certain amount of memory, a collection of storage, and possibly some add-on cards such as GPUs or other cards for specific workload needs. All of these need to be chosen by you for their features, but also sized appropriately. And this, the sizing, is one of the main issues with using physical servers. These resources collectively form the capacity of the physical server. They influence how much can be run on that server before it shows performance issues. But, and this is often forgotten, it's this capacity that you've paid for, and so ideally you want to consume it in its entirety so that your business gets maximum value. Now, what runs on a physical server varies, but at a conceptual level, you start with the operating system, the software which allows you or an application to interact with the hardware. Now, you'll want to run something on this operating system, maybe an application, but applications use runtime environments, so these are dependencies and libraries. If you run an application written in Java, for example, there's going to be additional things that run within that Java runtime environment which are required for your application, and these also consume resources. Now, at this stage, you have a functional application running within the runtime environment on the operating system. But what about all of this? This is the capacity of the server which you aren't using. And there are two main ways of handling this. One, it's wasted, so you don't consume it and it just sits idle. You're basically throwing away or burning money. You might not have given sizing much thought when you chose the specific type of server, or you might have sized the server much larger than you need to cope with sales or other busy periods, but unless you use it, you waste it. Alternatively, you could consume it with other applications. This means you're not wasting any money as your investment in hardware is being used, and if you pick applications which have their usage peaks at different times, you can actually be pretty efficient with hardware utilization. But, and this is a major risk with this approach, if one of the applications fail, this can cause the other applications to fail. One disruption causes other disruptions, and before long, much of your business stack can be offline. Historically, this was how IT was done, with servers. You picked the hardware, you sized them, you added some buffer to cope with busy periods, and hoped for the best. This approach tended to be risky and wasn't effective at using resources well. And that's where virtual servers or virtualization comes in handy. And let's look at that next. With virtual servers, things are slightly different. We still use physical servers, only now we refer to this as a host, a virtual machine host, or a VM host. And since this host is still just a physical server, it has resources, so CPU, memory, storage, and optionally add-on cards, just the same as physical servers. Now, before we talk about how this VM host runs your typical operating system, runtime, and application stack, there's a new component which I want to introduce, a hypervisor. Now, there are many different vendors which make hypervisors. You might have heard of VMware, Hyper-V, VirtualBox, Xen, KVM. These are all examples of hypervisors or hypervisor stacks. The job of a hypervisor is to manage physical resources within a server. So physical resources in a server are designed to have one thing accessing them, the operating system. With virtual servers, you're carving up the physical capacity, allowing multiple virtual machines to run on the same physical hardware. And so something needs to sit in the middle to act as a referee or arbiter, and that's the job of the hypervisor. So now we have the capacity of our VM host, capacity which is accessed via the hypervisor. Now, I'm not going to go into detail of how hypervisors work at a deep technical level in this video. That's a topic for another dedicated video. Conceptually, just imagine the hypervisor is working behind the scenes controlling access to physical resources. The operating systems that run on top of the hypervisor, they don't even need to be aware of it. So on top of the hypervisor, we create and run virtual machines. These are just like physical servers, in that they each have an operating system, one or more runtime environments, and one or more applications. But they're virtual. They have no direct access to the server hardware. Instead, they access the VM host hardware via the hypervisor. Now, virtual machines can be all the same sized, or you can create bigger and smaller virtual machines, which are sized perfectly for the specific job that they need to do. You can configure a VM host so that each virtual machine has its own dedicated resources, and this means you never go over 100% of what physical hardware the host has, or you can oversubscribe. If you have 20 virtual machines which only consume resources 50% of the time, they could, in theory, be put into a host which could otherwise only host 10 virtual machines which consumed resources 100% of the time. What's really important to remember, especially when I talk about containers in a different video, is how virtual machines are isolated. They have their own operating system, they're self-contained. They generally have their own allocation of resources so they can be as active and as noisy as they need to without impacting other virtual machines. In fact, if you have the failure of one virtual machine, then it should only impact that one specific virtual machine. You should be able to reboot that one VM without impacting any of the others. You can patch VMs without impacting other virtual machines. You can even change the size of a virtual machine, so allocating more or less resources as the requirements on that VM change. In most cases, you won't just have one VM host, instead having multiple controlled by the same hypervisor. Your pool of resources would be split across multiple underlying VM hosts, and you can even move or migrate virtual machines from one VM host to another while they're running. And this can either be an explicit action performed by you or an automatic process to handle capacity needs, or it can be due to one of the VM hosts failing. And in this sense, virtualization can help your ability to recover from failure in a disaster scenario. Virtual machines are much faster to start up versus physical machines. They don't have the same hardware testing process to go through, so reboots and cold starts can be much quicker. They also offer much better resource utilization versus physical machines. You can host many VMs on a single physical host while not having the risk associated with many applications running on the same OS. Instead of having many applications on one operating system, you have many virtual machines, each hosting a single application on their operating system. The virtual machines are entirely isolated, each running their own copy of the operating system, and this means each of them is protected from the activities of others. But this also might mean that you waste resources because each copy of the operating system needs its own resources to run. If you're running 50 copies of the same operating system, say Debian, then you're wasting a lot of resources because of this duplication. And this wastage due to duplication is something that containers fix, and that's something I'm going to be talking about in a separate video. Now, at this point, that's everything I wanted to cover. I've talked briefly about physical servers and virtual servers, I've talked about the differences, and you can use this knowledge to fully understand the benefits provided by using containers. But at this point, that's everything I wanted to cover in this video, so go ahead and complete the video, and when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.